early 1980s, at the dawn of the Eisner dynasty, Roy E. Disney, then head of the studio's animation division and Walt Disney's nephew, met with the newly inducted CEO to discuss the possibility of creating another installment to Fantasia. Under the working title of Fantasia Continued, the film would feature a mixture of original pieces coupled with reused segments from the first film. Eisner seemed open to the idea, but was reluctant due to the poor box office returns of the original. He suggested a more modern take on the film, and even proposed including pop songs from modern artists like the Beatles. Roy was apprehensive, but eager to have the project greenlit, said he would look into the possibilities. There was another catch, though. Due to Eisner's lack of faith in the film, Roy would have to find his own way to fund it, as Jeffrey Katzenberg, the then head of the Disney Film Division and Roy's boss, wanted no part of it. Roy and his team decided the best place to begin would be with examining how the original came about. Throughout the summer of 1940, the Disney animation team was frantically adding the final touches to their latest experiment in animation, Fantasia. Originally planned as a musical short meant to reignite public interest in Mickey Mouse, who had recently been eclipsed in popularity with Walt's latest star, Donald Duck, the project quickly grew into Walt dubbed his concert feature. Designed as an ongoing series of interchangeable animated segments paired with classical music, the film was meant to form a program of sorts. Walt and his brother Roy were busy trying to strike the proper deal with theaters for Fantasia's release, with many citing the film's runtime, almost 2.5 hours with an intermission, as a potential deterrent for audiences. The unusual nature of the film was also leaving owners conflicted. Many expected the simplistic, audience-appealing story and songs that Snow White and Pinocchio had, and were surprised with the impressionistic and artistic format. The price tag attached to the film didn't help either. Walt wanted to recreate the experience of sitting in a concert hall and watching a live orchestra perform along to the film, and by partnering with the technicians at RCA, he devised a 64-speaker setup that each theater would have to refit their auditoriums with, which he dubbed as Fantasound. The installation cost for each Fantasound setup was around $85,000. Disney partnered with a small company run by two gentlemen by the names of Bill Hewlett and Dave Packard to create 8 model 200B audio oscillators, a first of their kind, to test these setups, leading to an eventual partnership that would span decades. To ensure the longevity of this Fantasound installation, Walt also insisted that each theater be individually leased to run Fantasia exclusively for an extended period of time, a practice that eventually caught up to the studio's loan limits. Eventually, Disney convinced RKO Pictures to handle the release, who billed it as a landmark roadshow event, a common practice for the cinematic musicals of the era.
This was an event. This is the kind of event you might even get dressed up to go to. And you paid a higher ticket price than you would for a regular showing of a movie at your neighborhood theater.
So it was not just a film that they were going to. It was an experience.
By the early 90s, production had stalled on Roy's Fantasia Continued project. Eisner had met with famed composer Leonard Bernstein to consult and conduct with the film back in 1989, and supposedly Bernstein even humored the notion of adapting the Beatles' catalog of songs for the film. But Bernstein's sudden death in 1990 left the film without a music consultant. Roy decided to hire Met opera conductor James Levine in Bernstein's place, and the two began sifting through hundreds of potential classical musical pieces, including abandoned concepts from the original. Eisner, who had grown more distant to the Fantasia idea as the years went on, decided to come up with his own suggestions of what to include.
The phone one day from Michael Eisner's car.
Michael Eisner had been to a graduation and thought that Pomp and Circumstance was something that everybody was familiar with, and that it might be a great piece of music for Fantasia.
And Michael said, it is such a universal piece of music in the sense that we're all so familiar with it being connected with something happy in our lives that we kind of tend to remember it.
And as Disney War author James B. Stewart writes about Eisner's ideas and the animator's response to them, Eisner proceeded to outline a plot for the segment. All the classic Disney heroes and heroines, Cinderella and Prince Charming, Ariel and Eric, march in a procession carrying their future babies, which they would present in a mass ceremony.
They ask you how you are, and you just have to say that you're fine when you're not really fine.
The animators were absolutely incensed by Eisner's suggestions, with one even calling it an appalling abuse of the characters. Still, Roy knew that Eisner was his best shot at having the film made, so they had to set out to make the best of the situation. The original Fantasia premiered at the Broadway Theater in New York on November 13, 1940, and proceeded to run for the following 49 weeks. 12 other theaters across the nation had agreed to showcase the film, including the Carthay Circle Theater in Los Angeles, where Snow White had held its own premiere 3 years prior. The initial public response was positive, but critics were split on the film. In his review, New York Times columnist Alan Downs wrote, "Let it be said at the start, from a musical point of view, that this Fantasia is indisputable proof of the amazing things that can be done by the combination of animated design, color, and music, and a most forbidding example of what not to do with this magnificent apparatus." While film critic May Tenney wrote that the film was beautiful, but also bewildering. "It is an overwhelmingly ambitious orgy of color, sound, and imagination." In possibly the most negative review that the film received, Dorothy Thompson of the New York Herald Tribune likened Walt to Hitler and wrote that she left the theater in a condition bordering on nervous breakdown. "I felt as though I'd been subjected to an assault, but I had no desire to throw myself in adoration before the two masters who were responsible for the brutalization of sensibility in this remarkable nightmare." Public response soon cooled as well, with many confused as to who this film was intended for. Most children had a hard time sitting through the slower and unfamiliar pieces, while many self-proclaimed highbrows thought the blending of animation and classical music shortchanged both mediums. A few segments did garner nearly universal praise, though, primarily The Sorcerer's Apprentice, the piece that featured the only pre-existing character in the film. The climax of Modest Mazursky's Night on Bald Mountain, and the subsequent denouement of Schubert's Ave Maria, were also lauded for their depictions of the cycle of life and death and good silencing evil. The dwindling box office sales and high production costs, an estimated $2 million in 1940, which would be around $36 million today, soon caught up to the studio, who would eventually go on to lose $820,000 on the film. In the coming months, Fantasia would also have another major obstacle to overcome. The outbreak of World War II prevented the film from being shown in Europe, severely limiting the film's international market. Soon, all the original Fantasound setups were dismantled and donated to the war effort. RKO was forced to adapt the film to appeal to a broader audience by shortening its runtime, first to an hour and 40 minutes, and eventually to an hour and 20, with the entirety of the Toccata and Fugue opening cut out. They even had to market it as a double feature with the Western epic, Valley of the Sun. With the mounting war abroad and unrest brewing with the animators at the studio, Walt was finally forced to abandon Fantasia and write it off as a commercial failure, an action that would haunt him for the rest of his life.
Following Pinocchio and coming into the Fantasia period.
Yeah, that about did it, you know.
But that was a new
artistic success, financial failure, you know.
Certainly an artistic success. It was a magnificent.
Well, some people would question that, too.
As with most of the Golden Age era of the Disney catalog, Fantasia was re-released several times over the following years, seven in fact, all with various segments re-added or eliminated. But it wouldn't turn a profit until after Walt's death with the 1969 reissue, where it found a dedicated audience from the psychedelically infused youth of the era. Similar to how Alice in Wonderland regained popularity, Fantasia's popularity with the colleges of America is what kept it alive, something that both the trailers and the posters for the film's reissue capitalized on. And at this point, I need to acknowledge the centaur in the room, as these reissues saw the removal of the offensive imagery from the pastoral suite. It was bad then, it's still bad now, it should have been removed, and it was. The success of the 1990 reissue, which grossed $25 million domestically, inspired Eisner to consider Fantasia for home release. After seeing massive success with Pinocchio, Cinderella, and Snow White, Fantasia seemed like the next logical step. Roy was initially against the home video idea, as he thought it went against what Walt wanted for his films, but eventually gave in to Eisner's pushing. Fantasia was released on November 1, 1991, nearly 51 years after its first premiere, and would go on to sell 14.4 million cassettes and discs, leading Roy to be thankful that he had conceded on the issue, as it provided the necessary funds for the sequel. By 1997, production had finally picked up speed on Fantasia Continued, now renamed Fantasia 2000. Eisner still insisted that the film feature pomp and circumstance, but had yielded on the princess mass wedding-slash-baptism idea in favor for a retelling of the biblical story of Noah's Ark, with Donald Duck in the role of Noah's assistant.
The ideas I came up with was that it'd be fun to do a Noah's Ark story from the point of view of that Noah must have had a really hard time to get all those animals on the ark. You know, he must have had to catch them and then drag them and push and shove, and it was just such an idea laden with comic possibilities.
Other additions to the film included an Al Hirschfield-inspired 1930s New York set to George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue, which, much like The Sorcerer's Apprentice in the original, had originally been planned to be a standalone piece that was then absorbed into the film. Igor Stravinsky's Firebird Suite was chosen to close the feature, as Roy felt it replicated the emotional journey of Night on Bald Mountain and Ave Maria. To honor Walt's idea that each Fantasia film could evolve and share segments, the original Sorcerer's Apprentice was selected to be included as well. Despite Eisner's pomp remaining, Roy was satisfied that the film seemed to have a strong lineup of pieces, and was very confident in the film's release.
Oh yeah, it's all coming together.
Rather than duplicate the sound-based technical advancements of the original, as surround sound had become a staple in all commercial theaters by this point, the Disney team instead partnered with IMAX to exclusively premiere the film, and thus became the first major studio to release a film in the IMAX process. Fantasia 2000 premiered at Carnegie Hall on December 17, 1999, and featured Levine conducting the Philharmonic Orchestra live in sync with the film. 2000 opened commercially on New Year's Day in 54 IMAX theaters that were part of the deal that would make up 50% of the total profit of the film. As with its predecessor, though, it did open to mixed reviews from critics. Roger Ebert wrote that 2000 as a film is not equal to the original Fantasia, maybe because it aims a little lower for broader appeal. He found that some of the segments were powerful, while a few others were a little pedestrian. Rhapsody in Blue and the Firebird Suite were the most well-received, while Eisner's beloved Pomp and Circumstance was almost universally derided as out of place and remedial for a film of this nature. And in a bizarre case of history repeating itself, by limiting the venues that were showing the film and instead focusing on a series of 7 very expensive global premieres, and banking on the technology behind the film rather than on the film itself, Disney ended up hindering their own box office returns in a very similar manner that Walt had done with the initial film's release. The IMAX theaters just didn't have the large seating capacity that the regular cinemas of the day boasted, and while the film was very impressive on that scale, few people ended up seeing it. The film eventually made $60 million in its initial run, against a $90 million budget, driving a permanent wedge in Eisner and Roy's rapidly deteriorating relationship. Today, Fantasia is recognized as both a Disney classic and a cornerstone in progressing the medium of animation, with Sorcerer Mickey serving as possibly the most iconic form of the character. He can be found anywhere from theme park shows and nighttime spectaculars to meet and greets, home video introductions, video games, mini golf courses, and merchandise. Lots and lots of merchandise. And besides Cinderella's slipper, this is one of the few instances where the clothing has possibly surpassed the character in fame, with the hat, wand, and robe all being featured in various forms of iconography throughout the Disney world. The Sorcerer's Hat even had its own dedicated attraction before its owner did. That is, if you ignore the Sorcerer's Workshop in the animation building in California Adventure, and most people do, since it's just on the way to the actually cool rooms of the Beast Library and Ursula's Grotto. Mickey's Filler Magic also features a tribute to the Sorcerer's Apprentice segment itself, with Donald replacing Mickey in the role of the apprentice, a rather ironic move considering the original purpose of the segment. The brooms in Yensid the Sorcerer also are pretty common to see nowadays, popping up anywhere from theme park entertainment to video games, and the most notable being Fantasia Music Evolved, an interactive platform where a user takes on the role of the conductor and manipulates the music to a wide variety of classical and pop pieces ranging from the Nutcracker Suite to Bohemian Rhapsody, making it as close to Eisner's vision for a pop Fantasia as we will probably get. As for the rest of Fantasia, references to the remaining segments can be found rather frequently, again mostly at the theme parks. Chernabog, the god of death featured in Night on Bald Mountain, is probably the next most well-known character after Sorcerer Mickey, but he's usually only brought in when the company needs a vaguely satanic antagonist and is never mentioned by name. It always struck me as odd to feature Chernabog as a sidekick rather than the main villain, usually as a precursor to Maleficent, who, while may be the mistress of all evil, but he's like an actual god. Fun fact though, Chernabog was based on the Slavic deity Chernobog, or Black God, whose counterpart is Belobog, or White God. Not to be confused with the god of surf culture, Billabong. And congrats on reaching the dumbest joke in the episode. Parades have oddly served as an ongoing source of representation, dating all the way back to the 1966 Disneyland Around the Holiday special, and when fans gripe that the current parades are nowhere the quality of the old ones, I will forever assume they want more cigar-smoking chickens in their theme park entertainment. The 2000s Parade of Stars in Disneyland, which exploited every last ounce of dignity Disney tourists had left, also featured segments from both Fantasias. In Florida, Spectromagic had an entire Fantasia unit, and the currently running Festival of Fantasy also features characters from Dance of the Hours in its finale. As of this video, the only permanent Fantasia-specific attraction is the Fantasia Carousel at Shanghai Disneyland, themed primarily to the Pastoral Suite. Fantasia Gardens Minigolf and Disney World follows in a distant second, which features a hole for every musical segment in the film. Not to be confused with the proposed Fantasia Gardens at the entrance of Disneyland Paris, which unfortunately does not live up to this very impressive concept art. I mean, a Sorcerer Mickey-themed ice skating rink?
You gotta admit, this is cool!
As for nighttime entertainment, Disney's Hollywood Studios, then known as Disney MGM Studios, first fireworks show featured music from Fantasia and an inflatable Sorcerer Mickey on top of the Chinese Theater. Today, pretty much every version of Fantasmic features imagery from the film, ranging from Chernabog to the Nutcracker's weirdly sultry goldfish dance. Current iterations of the show even weave in motifs from several of the film's segments, which is probably due more to Disneyland's update taking 75% of its new music from Tokyo's version, rather than an intentional effort. If anything, the show's title serves as the best advertising for the film, as tourists seem to constantly conflate the two. Also, this has absolutely nothing to do with Fantasia, but I don't know where else I'd include this, and if I have to suffer, so do you. When the new version of Disneyland's Fantasmic premiered in 2017, it replaced the Pinocchio segment with the Genie from Aladdin, and at one point, Genie would reveal his harem dancers to be the princesses in bikinis. This only existed for the first couple nights as far as I know, and I honestly doubted what I saw then until I came across this video. They have now been replaced with monkeys. Do with that information as you will. More often than not though, you end up seeing more of Fantasia's general influence on the parks rather than outright depictions. Fantasia 2000 has sadly not fared quite as well as its predecessor in representation. Despite a strong advertising campaign, which included more parade representation and themed Main Street Emporium windows to coincide with the film's release, it's now virtually non-existent in the parks. Several sequences have cameos in California Adventure's World of Color, and the flying triangles of Beethoven's Fifth were featured in Japan's Fantasmic, but that ended in early 2020. The only real permanent representation is at the All-Star Movies Resort in Florida. It may gain a more permanent representation in the future, and I for one hope it does, but for now it's been relegated to gather dust in the Museum of Forgotten Properties next to Atlantis the Lost Empire and Dinosaur. Eight years later, Fantasia's legacy lives on. It continues to evolve and inspire through its celebration of animation, technology, and its demonstration of the universal truths and emotional resonance that music has, or as Angela Lansbury puts it, a celebration of life, death, and renewal. And while not necessarily in the format Walt originally intended it for, it seems that Fantasia is destined for renewal itself. The continued interest in potential subjects like the Little Match Girl short, and the success of such experimental works like the recent Short Circuit series on Disney Plus exhibit the same forward-thinking passion and heartfelt creativity that's found within the Fantasia films. And I think several of these shorts would fit in very nicely with a future Fantasia installment. I'm glad that the Fantasia films live on. They serve as rare examples of celebrating art over profit. Much like their own creations, they're flawed and surprising and honest, and sometimes that can serve as the greatest inspiration of all. Hey everyone, Tyler here. Thank you so much for watching. For those that have seen either Fantasia, what segment is your favorite? Or what musical suggestions would you have for a potential future installment? Do you think pop music could work? Comment below, I'd love to hear your thoughts. And as always, if you liked what you saw, feel free to subscribe or check out the other videos on our channel, or even comment on what topic you think we should cover next.